Hello, and again, a warm welcome to the College of the Holy Cross's Teaching for Better Humans Zoom event. My name is Danielle Pochet, and I am a visiting assistant professor of education at Holy Cross. This event is organized by our education department with support from the McFarland Center for Religion, Ethics, and Culture. Indeed, without the McFarland Center, this event would not be possible. So a sincere thank you to all who helped pull this event together, from those in the McFarland Center, to those in the Holy Cross IT department, to the panelists themselves for accepting our invitation. The theme for this evening, Teaching for Better Humans, was inspired by the moment we find ourselves in as a country and as a human race, and the belief that teachers and schools can help students grow into better human beings. Each of the panelists were asked to help us explore what it means to teach for better humans, and in particular to explore two questions which are at the heart of tonight's event. First, how can we help students grow into better humans? And secondly, how can a focus on teaching for better humans help address the structural inequalities that we see all around us, especially when considering the pandemic and the Black Lives Matter movement? There's been a slight change of plans for our event tonight. Regrettably, one of our panelists, Liz Kleinrock, cannot be with us. While we will miss her contribution, we still have two amazing and distinguished panelists with us this evening to help us explore what it truly means to teach for better humans. So let me introduce them to you. Tonight, one of our panelists joining us is Dr. Sonia Nieto. She is a professor emerita at the University of Massachusetts Amherst in language, literacy, and culture. Her commitment to teaching and learning began at an early age. In fact, Sonia decided to become a teacher, I believe, at age 6. And since then, she has devoted her professional life as an educator to questions of diversity, questions of equity, and social justice. She has taught in New York public schools, where she was born and raised, in Brooklyn, as well as in the Bronx. Her professional journey eventually took her to higher education, where she taught and mentored pre-service and practicing teachers and doctoral students at UMass from 1980 until 2006. And while she's formally retired from teaching, she hasn't retired from life, as I've heard she likes to say. She is a renowned author and researcher who continues to write and share her wisdom with others. Sonia herself has authored or edited 11 books, including Why We Teach Now and Finding Joy in Teaching Students of Diverse Backgrounds, Culturally Responsive and Socially Just Practices in US Classrooms. Her first book, Affirming Diversity, is now in its 7th edition and was selected by the Museum of Education as one of the 100 books that helped define the field of education in the 20th century. Her book, Affirming Diversity, I can say has profoundly changed me as a person and provided me with direction and comfort in my own vocation as a teacher. I use her work extensively in my courses here at Holy Cross, so my students can also find comfort and direction in her words and expertise. Also joining us tonight is Mr. Jesse Hagopian. He is another distinguished guest of ours. Currently, Jesse teaches ethnic studies at Garfield High School in Seattle, which is also his alma mater and the first school to boycott high-stakes standardized testing in the United States, a boycott that has started a national and international movement against standardized testing, and one that Jesse and his students helped ignite. Prior to teaching in Seattle, he taught in Washington, D.C. In addition to teaching ethnic studies, he has also taught history in our public schools. Jesse is the ultimate example of a teacher activist. He advocates for his students, for his fellow teachers, and for a better vision of schooling through his teaching, his community organizing, and through his writing. He's a co-editor for the social justice periodical Rethinking Schools and a co-editor of the book Teaching for Black Lives. And upon reading Teaching for Black Lives, Opal Tomati, one of the founders of Black Lives Matter, said, "This book is not just for teachers in the classroom, but also for those of us who care about making Black Lives Matter in the community. It should be required reading for all who care about the future of Black youth." Jesse is also a founding member of Social Equity Educators, which seeks a progressive approach to education. And he is the recipient of the 2019 Racial Justice Teacher of the Year Award from the NAACP Youth Coalition. Please check out his website, iamaneducator.com, for inspiration. I send many of my students here at Holy Cross. I send many of them to his website as they're discerning whether or not they want to become teachers. And I'm grateful that I have a place like his website to send them, a virtual space where they can familiarize themselves with Jesse's work, but also a space where they can see a living example of what it means to be a social justice educator today. Please also check out Sonia's website, sonianieto.com, which is filled with resources and inspiration for students and teachers at every level of schooling, and for those of us who are seeking to make the world a better place through education. And without further ado, let us hear from our panelists on how we can help students grow into better humans. I'll invite Sonia to speak to us first.
Thanks very much for the introduction and for the invitation. I'm so happy to be here, and I'm thrilled to be sharing this space with Jesse, who I have great respect for. I've spent over 50 years as an educator, and yes, I did retire a few years ago, but you know, I keep coming back to it. I really haven't left. So I'm still active professionally, but I'm not teaching anymore. So I'm going to respond to your questions as not only a teacher, a professor, and a researcher, but also as a mother and grandmother. I have two daughters. We've raised three children and have 12 grandchildren and a great grandson, just very recent. So let me try to tackle the first question by first reminding us that not all people have been regarded as human beings. And I think that's really important, because in order to know how to teach for better humans, we need to know our history. Definitions about who is human and what it means to be human have unfortunately left us with a historical legacy that is both shameful and criminal. And these definitions and classifications have followed us into the present. Traditionally, they're based on color, culture, including language, and caste. And they've also determined who has the power to decide who's human and who's not human. So to take one example, when Europeans landed in the Americas and faced indigenous populations for the first time, and shortly after that, when they kidnapped and brought Africans to the Americas, not just to the United States, and they brought them into slavery, there was a raging controversy about whether people in these groups had souls, that is, whether they were human beings or not. That's a really important historical understanding to have. So here they were, you know, talking about who has a soul, because if you have a soul, then you're human. So clearly the suggestion that they were not served as a justification for slavery and genocide and all sorts of exploitation. Apparently the Catholic Church was the first to admit that they did indeed have souls, but it left a terrible legacy and the damage had been done. Religion, as we know, and especially the Bible, was and still is occasionally quoted as a rationale for both enslavement and for the many laws and traditions that followed. And these include Jim Crow, miscegenation, segregation, redlining of neighborhoods, and so on. And you can say, well, that was the past. You know, we don't live like that anymore. It's old history. But the reality is that these ideas took on a life of their own, and whether we want to believe them or not, they've been ingrained into our consciousness, and that's all of us. So in answer to the first question, how can we help students grow into better humans? Let me make a couple of suggestions. And if there's time, we can expand on them later. We can help students grow into better humans, first of all, by teaching them our history. That's something that, you know, I felt that we haven't done very well. And we also haven't taught, like pre-service teachers, our educational history. Now, our history has many tragic and unfortunate parts, but it's something that everybody needs to know if the nation is to move on. So this means not only US history, but also the history of colonialism and imperialism, and importantly, for those who want to be teachers, the history that has shaped the course of public education since its inception in the late 19th century and through today in policies and practices that have led to brutal inequality in schools and in schooling. I think every pre-service teacher should take a course on the history of public education, because otherwise we end up with, you know, just repeating what we've heard about how education is the great equalizer and that, you know, and so on, and all the myths that we have about schooling. So the other thing that I want to mention is that I don't believe that we can teach students to become better human beings, either through what I call morality lessons, you know, what's right and wrong, but only through two ways. One is through knowledge, and I've already mentioned that, that everybody needs to learn our history, but also by modeling what it means to be a moral human being. I have to admit that, you know, this is something that I really learned a lot from my husband, who was a fabulous teacher until he retired. And you know, that's how he also taught me in terms of our own children, that to teach people to be, to have empathy, we have to have empathy. You know, we can't just say it. We need to demonstrate. If we want them to learn to follow good rules, not bad rules, of course, then we need to do that as well. And if we want them to be invested in the lives of others, we need to show them what that looks like, and so on. So I actually brought a couple of examples that I want to share with you. The first is from a teacher that I've collaborated with a lot, Mary Ginley. She's in a book that Jesse is also in, which is why we teach now. And she was an extraordinary teacher. She taught for 42 years and you know, was just incredible. And she took class with me. So she was one of my students, I'm honored to say. So this is a little example of what I mean by example. She put up a poster every year of Norman Rockwell's Ruby Bridges up in the classroom, she said. She never said anything about it. She just put it up there for them to see. And then finally, somebody would say, "Hey, what's with that kid?" "What kid?" I'd say. "You know, the little black kid in the white dress with the cops." And then I said, "What do you think is happening here?" And there was usually silence. She said, "I taught fifth grade in Florida. The idea that I would have a class where no one knew the story of school integration blew me away." Somebody take a look carefully. And one by one, the guesses would come. She's being arrested because she skipped school. She's in trouble because she didn't do her homework. The cops came to bring her to a new foster home because her dad was hurting her. And then Mary would say, "Look carefully at the picture. What else do you see? Rotten tomatoes? Whoa, what's that all about? Oh, Miss Ginley, there's a swear on the wall," and so on. And so then she decided to tell them to go look it up and see what they could find out. So they would come back and talk about it. And she said, so then, you know, she would teach them about the Brown versus Board of Education. And I would start asking questions. "Would you go to the school if you were going to be the only black kid, the first one to integrate the school? Would you send your child if she was going to be the only black kid? What was good about that?" What was good was that it was inconceivable to all of them how someone would object to integrated schools. However, I needed to take it a step further. That was the 1960s. Now we're in the 21st century. And she would say, "Segregation is against the law now. Does that mean discrimination and racism don't exist anymore?" and most of the kids would nod their heads enthusiastically. There isn't any more racism, not now. Martin Luther King and Brown versus Board of Education took care of all that. But the African-American kids in the class would look at each other and then at me. Usually the one of them would slowly shake his or her head. And I'd say, Rosa, well, I think there's still racism, she said. Like when I go in a store with Liz, who's white, and we split up and they follow me around and not her. Yeah, said Eric, people look at us different. Then Julie said, I told my teacher last year that I wanted to go to Harvard. And my teacher said it would be hard to get into Harvard and I might want to think about something else. But Sarah said she wanted to go to Harvard and the teacher told her that she could make it if she tried. I wonder if it was because Sarah was white or maybe Sarah's smarter than me. And Mary wrote, or maybe someone thought a child of color from Haiti who had an accent could never make it into Harvard. And this is why I continue to teach, she said, because someone has to make sure white kids realize that everyone isn't living happily ever after in a racism-free world. And smart Black girls with accents know that they can go to Harvard if they set their minds to it. So that's an example of modeling of, you know, without hitting people over the head. I mean, sometimes you have to do that too, I guess. But I mean, this is the you know, the kinds of lessons that I learned from teachers who I've worked with over so many years. So I have an answer to the second question, but we can wait for that. That's okay. I don't want to take too much time.
Okay, well, we'll come back to the second question because I know we'd love to hear. Jesse, I'd like to invite you to share your thoughts with us.
Well, first, thanks for that really generous introduction. And it just blows my mind that the website and the writing that I do is so useful to young teachers. It's wonderful to hear that. And it's really an honor to be with you all and with Sonia. It really blew my mind when you reached out to have me write something for your volume. And I really appreciate all your life's work that's made so many of us, inspired us to keep going in this struggle for teaching for better humans. And I love the premise of what we're getting into today, because it's not the starting place for most of the people in power who are running the education system. You only have to look to the recent Constitution Day convention that was held at the White House, where President Trump convened a panel of quote unquote historians and educators, quote unquote, to talk about what is wrong with the radical education that your kids are receiving. And they proceeded to deny that institutional racism exists in America and that therefore the teaching of critical race theory, all the work by Howard Zinn and the Zinn Education Project and the 1619 Project are all about indoctrinating kids. And they claim that that's why the riots in Portland were happening, because they had all read A Young People's History of America, which as a recent employee of the Zinn Education Project, I took a lot of pride in. But I think that, you know, for those in power, their goal with public education is blind indoctrination into patriotism, supporting our country unquestionably, regardless of the brutality that it has exhibited. And you just have to listen to the words of the president to understand that perspective and how backwards it is. And so I think that if we lived in an egalitarian paradise, we wouldn't have to teach to transform, but that's not the world we live in today. And so we need education to be about solving real problems that we have in the world. And You know, I recognized this very quickly when I began teaching in Southeast Washington, D.C. I was just out of college and moved to D.C. and I would drive by the White House and about 10 minutes later, cross the Anacostia River and I'd be in a section of the country that I really didn't know existed, right? We have poverty and racism and segregation in Seattle, but this was on another level. And the complete abandonment, the organized abandonment that occurred was breathtaking. And, you know, the first assignment I ever gave my students was to take, this was in a fifth grade classroom. I wanted them to take this brown paper bag home with them and put something in it that really represented who they were. And I said, don't just put a game or something that you like, but something that tells me about who you are. And the next day, my second day ever as a teacher, they came back and were seated in a circle. And the first girl pulled out a driver's license and she explained that it was her dad's and he was recently incarcerated and she wasn't going to see him. So she carried it with her. The next student pulled out a photo of his dad who had been shot and killed over the summer. And every single student in the circle pulled out some piece of memorabilia to remember somebody who was either dead or in jail. And it was an overwhelming experience for me. And I was panicked. I didn't know how I was going to meet the needs of my students. And this was in 2001. And it was only a few days into my teaching that the attacks on 9/11 occurred. And we saw the smoke rising from the Pentagon. And that was also terrifying. But I want to tell you something else that scared me, which was that our nation could mobilize hundreds of billions of dollars to go bomb people all over the world, but couldn't find the resources to fix the hole in the ceiling of my classroom that was just minutes from the White House. And the first research project I ever gave my students was destroyed before I could even hear them present on their favorite change maker from history because it rained into my classroom and destroyed the projects. I had to push a oversized garbage can underneath that hole for all 3 years I taught there to collect the rainwater. And I learned something profound about our nation's priorities and the way our nation views education, right? Especially for Black and brown kids, for our BIPOC youth, education is about ranking and sorting them into the lowest level of society. And they don't need resources and support because it's about getting them prepared for low-wage jobs or for prison. And that's really what motivated me to want to help transform the purpose of the education system. And, you know, I think those in power will often say that education is important. They say, if you study hard, you can get ahead. And they want to use education as a way, I think, to shame people, especially BIPOC and low-income working class people, to believing that they deserve their lot in life because they didn't achieve a high score on that standardized test. And they all have quotes about how education is the civil rights movement of our time. But really, I think they hope that Black and brown people will be content at individual achievement through education. They want to see the purpose of education as it's about how you do as an individual rising and not about collective creativity, imagination, and struggle. And, you know, we're living in very dangerous times. Hate crimes are on the rise. In Seattle, they've doubled in the last year, right? I had a student when I taught middle school here in Seattle just a few months ago. He's now an adult, but just a few months ago, he's walking down the street and a pickup truck pulled up and yelled the N-word at him and started shooting a gun at him. And luckily, he ran off and escaped and was unharmed. But I mean, for me, that really drove home the polarization that's happening in our society and the rise of white supremacy that's occurring. And our school system has to have something to say about that, right? And so I want to fundamentally transform education. I think that we need to rethink the purpose of it, because I think for too long from its inception, elites saw the purpose of education as integrating people into an inequitable economy. And I think we need to see it as about unleashing human potential. And so I think to do that, we can break down barriers in the education system, and even barriers between the subjects. Like, I think we need to rethink the whole school system, right? Instead of having kids sorted into different classes based on academic disciplines, what if we had different problems in our society as the title of our courses? And then we taught the subjects through problem solving, right? So for instance, we could have a course called Should We Defund the Police? And we could have the math teachers talk about the police budget and compare it to the budgets of healthcare and education in the cities, and have them learn statistics and all different kinds of math through that. And in the same course, we could teach language arts, where the kids write speeches about their beliefs on this question. And we could teach the history of policing, and we could talk about how it emerged from slave patrols. And we could teach all number of academic disciplines through actually trying to help solve real live questions that are relevant to our students' lives, right? And I think we have to do that. We have to rethink how education works in our society today. And I'll just end by saying that this is so urgent because we face immense social crises, right? We have a system of mass incarceration that has more Black people behind bars on probation or parole than were enslaved on plantations in 1850. That is a social catastrophe, and education has to have something to say about that, right? 1 in 3 women report having faced sexual assault in our country today. That is a social catastrophe that education needs to address, and especially empower young boys and men to help solve, right? I think that when you look at the fact that over 500 children were separated from their parents on the border and still haven't been reunited, and they can't even find their parents now to reunite them, that is an obscenity in our country that education has to have something to say about. We have endless wars now. This war that was begun when I began teaching is still going on today. Our young people know nothing but spending trillions of dollars to bomb children around the world rather than to educate them here. We have levels of income inequality that are off the charts, right? 8 people have the same amount of wealth as the bottom 3.5 billion people on the planet. And climate change is threatening the very existence of humanity. And education has to tackle these questions if we're going to continue as human beings on the planet. So I want to encourage us to think about teaching for imagination and civic courage and empathy and creativity and critical thinking, not just to bubble in a test score and gain individual achievement. So thanks for inviting me to share those ideas with you all today.
Thank you, Jesse. And thank you, Sonia. I know I am itching to ask you questions, and I know the students here with me tonight are probably also itching to ask you questions. I just want to introduce them to everybody before we begin. So with me, I have 3 Holy Cross students here to ask Sonia and Jesse questions. about what it means to teach for better humans. Ashley Rodriguez-Lentigua is a sophomore at Holy Cross. She's double majoring in sociology and Latino Africana studies with a minor in education. Jamil Davis is now an English major with an Africana studies concentration. He was recently also accepted into Holy Cross's teacher education program. And Tom Kremens is a senior pursuing a degree in economics with a minor in education. They are each passionate about education and curious to learn more from Sonia and Jesse. In addition to myself and the student moderators, you all viewing this event are welcome to submit questions via the Q&A button that you can find at the bottom of your Zoom screen. While we may not be able to address each question asked because of time constraints, I'll be keeping track of the questions that you submit and do my best to share them with our esteemed panelists. So to start us off, I'll turn it over to our student moderators to kick off our conversation. Ashley, Jamil, Tom, you may virtually raise your hand when you're ready to ask your first question.
One of the things you guys both had spoke on, where Sonia has spoke on models in our models and morals in our classroom, and Jesse had spoke on having a lot of students having their fathers and the incarceration rates of 1/3 of Black men being kind of locked up in jail systems within America, and with being in jail, you're disbarred from the possibility of teaching. So one of the things I kind of want to ask you guys about is there a calling for people of diverse backgrounds to teach? And if so, what about being paid a living wage, as being a teacher is not very much so a lucrative job at times, and that maybe keep people from wanting to do it. So why should a young college student want to teach?
You know, I think that not everybody decides at the age of 6 or 8 or 10, you know, to be a teacher. Some people fall into it. And for some, there was a teacher who was one of my students actually, who wrote an essay for one of my books called The Accidental Teacher, because it's something, she loved science and she loved kids, and she thought she'd be a doctor, but then she decided to be a teacher to teach science. And it was so hard that she had to leave. So then she tried again. And the second time she had to leave. So her father said, why don't you go and take this, what's that test that they give you to see what field you should pursue? And when she went for the results, the man said to her, well, you know, the results are that you should be a teacher. And she said she just started crying, because she had tried it twice and it had been so hard. So the point is that it is very hard. It's not lucrative. You're not gonna become a millionaire or a billionaire if you teach. But, you know, if you are grounded in social justice, if you see all the inequities that Jesse was talking about, if you see them in your family, but even more important, if you don't see them in your family, you know, this is a profession where you can change lives, not by indoctrinating students, but by opening doors for them. So I think that is, you know, enough for some people. And I think that we should, you know, to answer a question that you had, Jamil, about are people trying to diversify the teaching force? Yes, I think that there is a real concern about that. I don't think that there's been a great deal of success. You know, you have to remember that when I was a young woman, there were two professions open to me. You know, being Puerto Rican, being a girl. The fact that I went to college, my sister and I were the first in our family to graduate from high school. So I could be a teacher or I could be a nurse. Luckily, I became a teacher, and it's a profession that I've loved for many, many years. But now young women and people of color have lots of different opportunities. And so we have to find a way to make them want to be teachers. And I think the way to do that is to help reform the education system. Like Jesse says, and I agree completely, we have to change it. We have to transform it. We have to start from the bottom up. And in that way, you know, I think that we can recruit a lot of people who would be interested, who would be passionate about teaching and working with young people.
To kind of go off of that question, both of you at different times have said that teaching has made you a better person. And that's one of the reasons why you've stayed in the profession. Would either of you or both of you speak to how teaching has made you better human beings?
Well, I'll just say it's made me much more empathetic. It's taught me so much about myself and the world. If you think back to that classroom of fifth graders I just described to you, you know, I understand the depths of the problems of structural racism in our society. You know, I faced it myself as a student and a Black person in this society, but seeing the way that ghettos were organized and the way that Black children were set up to fail, transformed me intellectually and emotionally. There's really no other way to say it. And I'll just say that I think that the young people who are in the streets today building the Black Lives Matter movement are a true inspiration. And I think myself and all educators would do well to open the space for those young people to talk about their experiences and their goals and aspirations in this struggle and learn from them and realize that I think the youth today are writing one of the greatest lesson plans in the streets of our country that has ever happened in my lifetime.
But for that to happen, schools need to change because there's very little opportunity for kids to just talk about their experiences, unfortunately, because I think that, we have such focus on the test and on discipline and on blaming students and blaming their families and so on. So, schools definitely need to change.
Thank you. Ashley, you have a question.
Yes, I actually have a question for Sonia. I completely agree with you when you said that we have to teach students their history and the history of the problems that they're encountering. But I'm thinking about how a lot of the curriculums that teachers in urban settings and in urban schools find are censored. So I was wondering if you have any ideas of how can we maximize that experience for students when we have to teach them a curriculum that is already censored. How can we bring culturally relevant pedagogy, which is something that you have actually done a lot of research on?
You know, I think first what teachers need to do is look at the history that they're given and understand that they alone are not going to change things. You know, and I think that that is a fallacy in our system that, you know, we always hold up, you know, one person as sort of the hero, the superhero, the super teacher. And so, you know, I would always say to my students when they would say, what's your advice for a first year teacher? One of the things that I always said is make a friend. Make sure that you're not doing this alone. Because doing it alone can really burn you out right away. That's why organizations like Rethinking Schools are so important, because even if you can't be in person with them, Jesse, I know, was able to do that because of where he was situated. But even if you're not in person, you can just learn so much from these organizations that work for social justice. So I think it's really important to understand that you alone are not going to change things. You can only change things when you get together with others. And it might start out small, but you know, it can make a huge difference. And you know, I feel very blessed because I was sort of in the first floor of the bilingual education movement. And so I taught in the first bilingual school in the Northeast. So it was, wow, you know, what a learning experience, because I never had bilingual education, you know, as a kid. Then I was recruited from there to a Puerto Rican studies department at Brooklyn College. And that, you know, so I was on the ground floor because it was, I think, the first Puerto Rican studies department. And so we had to create things as we went along. And so, you know, it meant learning. I didn't know the history of Puerto Ricans on the island or in the United States. You know, who knew that? Not me. I certainly wasn't taught that. My parents didn't have formal education, so they couldn't teach me. And so I learned in my late 20s a lot of what, you know, what it was that I needed. So I think that, you know, it is important to understand that we need to work with others and we need to always be learners. You know, that's one of the things that I've learned over the years. Every day I learn something new, even now, even though I've been retired for several years. And learn from others. You know, as Jesse was saying, he changed for the better when he became a teacher, and that certainly happened to me. I learned so much from my students. Either, you know, my middle school students or intermediate school, they called it then, my intermediate school students or, you know, my college students, my doctoral students. I've learned so much from all of them over the years.
Yeah. Tom, you have a question?
Yeah, thank you, Professor. And so this is in regards to, Jesse, something that you said in your introduction. So first off, I think that is an excellent idea that we, you know, in this country, in our schools, that we should be teaching about current social justice issues and current, you know, current events in the classroom across all subjects. And I think that is actually essential if we want to be, you know, teaching for better humans, like the theme tonight. I think it's absolutely essential. But my question is, you know, with all the things that are going on right now in our country, socially, it seems as if students, specifically students who may not be affected by these issues, I would say probably white students who are not affected by these issues, get very uncomfortable when you bring up these topics, and it seems as if they're not very comfortable talking about it. So how can you engage students, you know, any student for that matter, who maybe seems to get very uncomfortable when these topics are brought up and they aren't really able to open up? How can you engage this type of student?
No, that's such an important question, because I think teaching for Black lives is not just about empowering Black students, although that's really important. I think it's about what Sonia started off with, having us all understand the common history of the people in this country and in this world. And so there's a couple things that I would do, but I think teaching the history of how race was created and the purpose of it, I think is an important place to start. And actually, I would say, before you even begin teaching that history, you have to build trust and relationships with your students in the classroom so that, you know, I tell my kids, we're going to be talking about things that most adults are too afraid to discuss. And race is something that most adults have no idea how to talk about. And it makes them very uncomfortable. And we're gonna do that. But to do that, we have to build a lot of trust in this classroom. And so we have to build a community, and we have to learn how to treat each other well, right? And we have to have things, restorative practices and peace circles in place to as the scaffolding to have these difficult discussions. Then I think when we teach the history of how race was created, it is so illuminating for our students, and it's empowering, I think, for all of our students to understand the role that they can play in being part of a struggle to end racism today. Because when you learn that the first laws written around race, probably in world history, were written after Bacon's Rebellion, when you had a multiracial uprising of Black and white indentured servants and slaves, enslaved African people, coming together, and they sacked Jamestown, and they occupied it for 8 months, and the king of England thought he had lost his most important colony and one of the most profitable places on the planet. And then to make sure something like that never happened again, right, they wrote laws to separate black and white. And Frederick Douglass described it as they divided both to conquer each. And what he meant by that was that, yes, of course they were conquering black people with these racist laws. That's very obvious. But what Frederick Douglass was urging white people to understand is that they too, in fact, were being conquered by these racist laws, because if they could pay black people $0 to work, they could pay a white person a penny and tell them that they are living well, right? At least you're not enslaved. And that's how the richest 1% have maintained their control on wealth from 1667 until today, right? And it's by dividing and conquering and inviting white people to understand that racism is also conquering them, and that if they want to get free, they're going to have to figure out how to join this struggle, is I've found empowering to my students.
Thank you. Ashley, do you have another question?
Yes, I actually had a question for Jesse. I've looked at a lot of the community organizing that you do, and I think it's really important. And I'm honestly wondering, like, how do you find so much the time to do both your teaching job and also do so much in the community? And how do you engage your students civically, or do you involve them in the community organizing that you do?
Yeah, it's a good question. I have to be honest that I haven't always balanced it well, and it takes a toll sometimes when you are organizing and writing and teaching all the time. And, you know, I want to urge people to find a balance that I haven't always been able to strike, because it will wear you down and stress you out if you are just fully engaged in this work and not also in taking care of yourself. I think that's something that our teachers and our movements need to learn better, and that I'm learning right now about self-care and mindfulness and practices that will help sustain us in these movements, right? In terms of engaging my students in the struggle, yeah, I've worked alongside them in lots of different capacities. You know, I never tell my students what to do or demand that they join this or that action, but I provide lots of opportunities for students who want to take action. The state legislature was getting ready to cut funding from our schools, and this was in the wake of the Great Recession. And they weren't funding our schools to their constitutional level. So I got together with a group of the social equity educators, and we went down to the House Ways and Means Committee meeting, and we read out the state constitution in the middle of their meeting and interrupted it. And then we staged a citizen's arrest, and I even brought some plastic handcuffs, and I asked them to come into my custody because they were violating the state constitution. And the police officer in the room didn't agree with my interpretation of the law, and he arrested me instead. And my students organized a walkout the next day at Garfield High School to demand full funding of the schools. And I didn't even know that they were organizing it. They just put up a Facebook page, and a day later there was 500 kids marching out of the school. But it's providing opportunities and examples of how to struggle, and then teaching about those struggles in our classroom that I think are effective.
Thank you. I'll pull in a question from the Q&A chat real quick from Marco. He asks, what should teachers do if they receive pushback from parents who do not want their children learning controversial topics or perhaps being involved, right, in a walkout from someone other than them?
Yeah. Sonia, do you have ideas? It's hard.
Yeah, that's really hard. And You know, I think that it is really important for teachers to sort of be prepared for that eventuality. And so that means to get to know the parents and the families, because a lot of times, teachers don't get enough education about working with families. And so it's not just about going to a PTA meeting. It really is about getting to know who, these families are. I remember one teacher who said that the best thing he ever did when he became a teacher was to put a coffee pot in his classroom. And then when the parents would come by to pick up their kids or to drop them off, he'd invite them to have coffee. And so he got to know them. You know, if you don't know the families, you have all sorts of ideas about who they are. And I think that especially if your race or ethnicity or language, social class are different from them, you might harbor all these misconceptions. So that's one thing, get to know who they are. And when you're going to teach something, I think it's really important to reach out to the families and tell them what it is that you're working on. And they might still object, but at least you'll be prepared. You can't always win that battle. And so I'll turn it over to Jesse, because I know you have a lot more experience, especially lately, than I have had lately.
Well, no, thank you for saying that. I appreciate that. And I think that is really important. I would also just pick up on what you said earlier about the collective approach to teaching and like making a friend, I think is so important that you're not doing this alone. If you can have several teachers who are teaching this together, then if there's pushback, you're doing it together, right? And that experience has been so important to us defending teachers who are doing this work. One way to do that is like start a study group, right? You could read, you could ask teachers to join you in reading Why We Teach Now or Teaching for Black Lives or whatever your favorite book is and read it together. And then the folks that you hear making the comments that you agree with, you'll know, okay, that's somebody who I can work with and collaborate with. And then you'll have each other's backs if there is a real struggle.
Thank you. I know for myself with teaching and both what you've shared in your work and what you've shared tonight reminds me of this. So much of the joy of teaching comes from these unexpected moments that we have between ourselves and students. And I was just wondering, how do you, each of you, how have you picked up on the serendipitous moments that happen in your classroom? What do you do with them and how do you use them to form human beings?
Gee, that's a really great question. I know, I've had so many of those serendipitous moments, but nothing comes up right now. So Jesse, maybe you can go and then I'll keep thinking.
Yeah, I have too. That's one of the joys of teaching is like when you hear something that connects to something you know about and you can illuminate right there on the spot. There's so many that I'm forgetting right now, but I know a powerful moment happened a couple years ago when a student of mine said that they knew a woman named Charlena Lyles who had just been killed by the police. And so we just actually stopped class. It was a world history class and we just stopped class and I wasn't going to go on with the daily lesson plan when this woman had been killed by the police in her own home. She had called the police for help because she thought her apartment had been broken into. And when they showed up a few minutes later, they had killed her. And so we spent the day talking about police violence and that history and what people could do about it and the protests that were being organized. And the students decided in class that day that they were going to have a rally on the front steps of Garfield High School the next day. And they and they built a rally to raise awareness about the case. And then they ended up forming an organization that's still ongoing to this day based out of that discussion in class. And, you know, taking those moments to say, you know, there's something just happened that's bigger than what I had planned, I think is important.
Wow, thank you for that example. Yeah. Sonia?
Well, I was thinking about, it's not exactly the same sort of thing, but, you know, it goes back to that issue of becoming better humans as a result of our interaction with students. And so, and I've written about this, it was in my first year of teaching, which was really hard, really, really hard. And I was teaching in an intermediate school. And one day I was writing something on the board, and all of a sudden I turn around and there's a spitball fight going on with many of the students. And they're just spitballs flying all over the place. And I started shouting, and I was, you know, I really lost control. I mean, I was, you know, 22 years old. I was, oh my goodness. And I thought, I remember thinking, maybe this is not what I should do, even though it's what I've wanted to do my whole life. Maybe this is not for me. It was my first or second month of teaching. And the end of class came, and the, you know, the bell rang, and most of the kids filed out. And one little kid, who's a little short guy, was, he had been right in the middle of this whole thing. He came over to me and he said, I was Miss Cortez at the time. He said, Miss Cortez, can I help you clean this up? And it just, wow. You know, I had to hold back the tears, because I thought, he is showing me that I can be better, you know, because he's seeing the humanity in me. Talk about teaching for better humans. And that was a great lesson for me. And so in spite of many other difficult days, you know, I thought about that a lot. And I always do think about it as, you know, a pivotal moment in my teaching.
Thank you both. It kills me because we are out of time, but I know Tom, I know Ashley, I know Jamil all have questions for you, more questions for you. The Q&A that I'm looking at here, there's about 13 questions that were submitted that we're not going to have the chance to get to. But is there anything that, before we end our time together, Sonia, Jesse, anything else you'd like to share with us or leave us with tonight?
Well, as the elder in the room, I will take advantage to say that I am really thrilled that there are young people who have this passion for becoming teachers and for changing our educational system so that it is full of justice, which it is not right now. So that, you know, I think that the Black Lives Matter movement and the pandemic have given us incredible opportunities. I know that I get depressed sometimes because of, you know, the anxiety of the election that's coming, everything that's happening. But young people give me a lot of hope that things can change and that they will, you know, continue this struggle. So thank you for the opportunity. Great to be with you. Great to be with you, Jesse, and with all of you.
Absolutely. So good to be with you all. Thank you, Sonia. Just wonderful opportunity to get to share this time with you. And I just want to encourage everybody to keep pursuing this passion for education and teaching. There'll be really hard days. And Sonia described one, and I've described some where you can't imagine continuing, but you, when you do, you find out that there's really no greater joy than getting to help empower a young person, right? To help transform them into somebody who loves themselves when the society outcasts them, right? there is no greater feeling than getting to help a young person understand their self-worth and also understand how they can join together with others to transform the world, and that they're powerful people. And that makes this the greatest job that you could ever hope to be a part of. And I'm so glad you all are pursuing this. And I hope you will continue to struggle for a day when education is no longer about the test score that you receive, but your vision for a better society and your commitment to fighting for that. So thanks for having me.
Amen to that. Well, thank you, Sonia and Jesse, on behalf of all of us here at Holy Cross. Thank you for being examples of what it means to love, to empower others inside and outside the classroom. Thank you for helping us understand a little bit more how we can become better humans ourselves, but also how we can help create a better world through education. For those interested, you will be able to find a recording of tonight's discussion on the McFarland Center's webpage. Thank you for joining us, and remember to stay human. Thank you, everyone.